Tonight on Line A Hand, Kevin Costner.
I didn't know. I'm just trying to be really honest about it. You know, you have to have a certain amount of self-doubt in anything you do, or you're just a pompous ass.
Helen Hunt.
I am quietly ferocious when I'm working on a part that I care about, and I certainly cared about this as much as any I've ever done.
And Cuba Gooding Jr.
He said, I want you to do this role. And I said, absolutely. He said, but I'm bald. And he said, well, then so is the character.
Hello, and welcome to this edition of Linehan. Well, it's a season of blockbuster movies. They don't get bigger or better than Jim Brooks' As Good As It Gets, Kevin Costner's The Postman, and Jim Cameron's Titanic. As a matter of fact, all of those movies are sure to be Academy Award contenders this spring. We're going to start with Jim Brooks' As Good As It Gets, Jack Nicholson, Helen Hunt, Greg Kinnear and Cuba Gooding Jr. in one of the best films of the year.
There's something extraordinary about this because it is a Jim Brooks movie, but you read the material first.
Yeah.
Under what circumstances did you read the original story?
My agent sent it to me, and I just loved the story, and it wasn't getting made yet. I had no shot at the part, but from a distance I thought that's a beautiful story. And then 3 years later I got a call that Jim had utterly rewritten it and made it his own, and Jack was going to play Melvin. And I just thought, after reading so many things that aren't any good, or that are perfectly nice but have been done before, this was a purely original piece, and it just seared my heart.
My doctor, a shrink that I used to go to all the time, he says that in 50 or 60% of the cases, a pill really helps. I hate pills. Very dangerous thing, pills. Hate. I'm using the word hate here about pills. Hate. My compliment is that night when you came over and told me that you would never... All right, well, you were there. You know what you said. Well, my compliment to you is the next morning, I started taking the pills.
I don't quite get how that's a compliment for me.
You make me want to be a better man.
That's maybe the best compliment of my life.
Well, maybe I overshot a little because I was aiming at just enough to keep you from walking out.
Tell us why, then, you told the New York Times that you felt, I knew... What are you laughing at?
I don't know.
Get out of here.
Tell
you
us
did.
Why you told the New York
what?
Times.
Okay,
oh,
Helen.
God, what did I tell them?
Why did you tell the
yeah.
New York
Isn't it
Times?
Also true?
Yes. You said I knew I would be a long shot to play the part.
Yes.
Why?
Well,
you felt so passionate about it.
Because I haven't played a part like this before, and very few directors have imaginations when it comes to casting, I think. If they see you in a part, they know you can play that part, but and when I said to Jim, I know I'm a long shot for this part, at first he agreed with me, and then once he got to know me, he said, I think there's more of her in you than you know.
When Jim Brooks says that some of the most wonderful things in As Good As It Gets would not have happened without Helen's pushing and probing, what's he talking about, Helen?
I don't know. I think I am quietly ferocious when I'm working on a part that I care about, and I certainly cared about this as much as any I've ever done, and usually I try to do that kind of quietly and not get in anybody's way. But in this movie, I had this partner in Jim who was just as, or more, obsessed with looking at it from every angle that we could possibly find.
We were so on the same page, this group and myself, and the same page was a tortured page. The same page was one that had us, you know, all at various 3 o'clock in the morning wishing we could get other work because it was just so hard and nobody knew exactly how to do it, you know, and I should have most of all, but least of all me. So we were all on the same page, which meant that we were really close, but that no niceties were observed. We talked very directly about the work. Nothing was layered over with honey, you know, the way you usually have to do it. Just, I mean, actors are entitled to it. You shouldn't. But here, you know, bluntness was the language we all spoke, and we needed to.
Can you explain, Jim, why there was any question at all, considering Jack Nicholson's character, that when he used the line, the introductory line, about Helen Hunt's character, Carol the waitress, Simon the fag, the next thing we knew, there were headlines on the entertainment pages saying, Chastity Bono will intervene on behalf of all gay and lesbian peoples in the Western world, and then Jack Valenti? I mean, the world needs Jack Valenti to comment on a line of dialogue? Why was it a controversy at all, considering what had already been established about Nicholson's character?
It was for a trailer, and the MPAA has a rule against saying fag on a trailer, and we needed to on this trailer. I felt we really needed to. And their argument was it's offensive to gay people. And our argument was, having a major studio executive and one of the producers of the film who were gay, our argument back to them was, as you know, you're straight, check with gay people. You know, check whether it's offensive. Don't just assume it. I think it's demeaning to assume it. And then they began to check, and we began to check, and you know, and we did our little polls, and Chastity came in as the head of an official organization, and it was great, I think, of Valente to just not take a smug, that's the rule, we're not going to change it, but to open himself up to information from the group that he was supposedly protecting, and I think that was great.
Hi. Thank you for being on time.
Hi.
Carol the waitress, Simon the...
Hello? Holy God, who did that to you?
I was attacked. I walked in on some men robbing me, and I was hospitalized. I almost died.
Small talk in the car. Let's go.
But what Greg Kinnear gives you in this movie is so extraordinary. Did Greg Kinnear know... by the way, I thought it was incredible that you thought he was gay when you hired him.
Yes, yeah.
What was the turning point where you found out, to your surprise, oh, you're not... Oh, okay.
He says it was 4 days later. I remember it was somewhat later than that, but he says it was 4 days later. But, it did bother me that he wasn't gay. It did. after believing the other.
I didn't want to discuss it one way or the other early on. Jim didn't bring up my... He never asked me if
sexuality.
I was straight or gay. I never was going to bring up the issue. It just, in my opinion, it was... First of all, I didn't think it mattered one way or the other. So the fact that it wasn't discussed was no, didn't bother me one bit. In fact, maybe I thought in the back of my mind, you know, to suggest I'm not might in some way hinder my getting the part, and that was contrary to what my big plan was. So I never mentioned a word about it. And finally, Helen, my fiance, came down to the set, and the look of sadness on Jim's face was quite extraordinary. But Helen was like, well, what did I do? What's wrong with them? And I said, don't worry, it has nothing to do with you and it has nothing to do with us.
When we return, more of Jim Brooks' As Good As It Gets.